Good morning, church. It's a privilege to stand before you this morning, and I apologize for the sore throat that I am having, and I don't know, but I'll request you to tolerate this voice for some time, and let us look to the Lord so that He may speak to us this morning. I wanted to start on a lighter note, and we know that something called the coronavirus is raging all around us, and mostly in China, people are dying every day. This morning's report is that nearly 35,000 people have been infected and more than 700 have so far died. And we don't know the reason why this epidemic has struck us, but many attribute it to the eating habits of the Chinese people. Many say that it is because of the bats they eat, and some say that it has come from the snakes. We don't know, but I came across a post by someone which says that Robert Mugabe, the former Prime Minister and President of Zimbabwe, and he was known for his hilarious statements, he once said, "If Adam and Eve were Chinese, then we would have been in the paradise today. Because they would have ignored the fruit and eaten the snake." I don't know, but I wish that it had happened. Let's now focus on the subject we want to meditate upon this morning. And I generally don't give a title to whatever I speak because they are so unorganized. But this morning I want to give it a title. It is In Christianity or in Christ. The title is In Christianity or in Christ. It is human nature to make oneself presentable. Wherever we go, we want that we should be presentable. Men would always wear a suit to a wedding, the tie in place, and fragrance dabbed on the hanky. And in case of women, I need not explain, they take a long time to prepare anyway. The whole idea is that people should see us and admire how smart, good, beautiful we look. Nothing wrong in that. But the question is, if we present ourselves putting on our best attire before God, will He be impressed? Chances are that it will not impress Him at all, because He looks deep into our heart. He inspects our thoughts. He will be happy if the aroma coming out of that place, the heart, pleases Him. It's not today, but for centuries, people have laid much stress on religion. James, the brother of Jesus, has defined religion for us in this manner. He says in James chapter 1, verse 27, "Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself unspotted from the world." To keep oneself unspotted from the world. Jesus, whom we love and we worship, knew the dangers of religion. He was hated by some of the most religious people of his time. While the sinners and outcasts of society, who were generally not liked by people, were attracted to him, while the Pharisees, the Sadducees, scribes and priests were against him. Who are these groups? The Pharisees were a Jewish religious group which attempted to keep Israel free of Gentile contamination by vigorously adhering to the scriptures and the oral traditions that applied the law of God to the details of daily life. The scribes were experts in biblical law, often found among the Pharisees. The Pharisees depended on the scribes for right interpretation of the scripture. The Sadducees were an upper-class Jewish religious group that rejected oral traditions of the Pharisees and insisted on a rigid interpretation and adherence to the Mosaic law. And the priests were descendants of Aaron, who inherited the responsibility of attending to the rituals in the temple in Jerusalem. They were closer to the Sadducees. The difference between Pharisees and the Sadducees was the Pharisees did not believe in resurrection, nor angels or spirits, but the Sadducees acknowledged them all. But Jesus described these people as hypocrites and blind leaders leading the blind. Matthew chapter 23, verses 27 to 29. If we read these verses, we'll come to know what he says. Jesus says, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. Blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and dish, and then the outside also will be clean." Verse 27, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You are like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of dead men's bones and everything unclean. In the same way, on the outside you appear to people as righteous, but on the inside you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness." Verse 29, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You build tombs for the prophets and decorate the graves of the righteous." Very strong words. One would think that Jesus' opponents should come from the atheists, the secular thinkers, criminals, and others. That wasn't the case. Street people, sinners, who are described as the scum of the society, were his friends. They liked Jesus and were attracted towards him. If you take a closer look, all the Pharisees and Sadducees were not bad people. They were clinging to religion seriously, and they were doing it very sincerely. They supported the idea of a God-centered life. Their commitment for the Jewish people could not be questioned. They wanted to keep Jews separate from the rest of the Gentile world. They were for sincere practice of the Mosaic law. They opposed Jesus because they thought he was saying something which was not in conformity with their religious teachings and beliefs as they understood that. They applied the law to the smallest details of life, but completely missed out on what God wanted them to do. That is really something interesting. Matthew chapter 15, verses 8 and 9, these verses say, These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men. Please mark these words. Their teachings are but rules taught by men. Jesus changed everything. His disciples turned the world upside down, as we are told. What till then was believed to be the best was found to be utterly useless. How interesting. He taught with an air of authority and said, God is not looking for people who were doing well in their religion, but is looking for people who are poor in spirit, who mourn, who are meek, who hunger and thirst for righteousness, who are merciful, pure in heart, and are peacemakers. If you take a close look at the list of the people, list of these people, you will find they did not rank high in world's list of important or great people. But God chose them. This is the greatest thing about them, and this is the greatest thing for our faith as well. The poor in spirit are those who recognize their dependence on God in every area of life. Those who mourn, grieving the nature and results of sin in themselves or in others. Who are the meek? The meek are willing to live under the authority of God. The meek doesn't mean that you hardly speak. You are very humble. It's not that. Those who are willing to live under the authority of God. And those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, they accept the righteousness, the rightness that comes from God. And who are the merciful? They are the people who give undeserved relief to others in the face of misery. And the pure in heart are the people who are clean on the inside. The peacemakers are who are working to reconcile people to their God and to each other. Every time you go and tell someone about the love of Christ, every time you go and tell someone about the gospel, you are trying to make peace between that man and God. You are a peacemaker. And once you make peace with God, then you will have peace with everybody, even your enemy, your bitterest enemy. I may be causing confusion in some minds, as we always thought that we attend the Sunday worship as it is part of our religious practice. I want that misconception should go. Christ was receptive to broken hearts rather than proud religion. Mark these words. Christ was receptive to broken hearts rather than proud religion. We are often very proud about our religion. Jesus was seen as a threat to religionists because anyone who accepted Jesus would never need religion of the Pharisees. We witness this in church today. If you are for spiritual growth, there will be many who will say they didn't. They don't need it. That's why our prayer meetings and Bible groups are so poorly attended, because we are happy with what we are doing. It's a serious matter, and we need to think about it again and again. Jesus taught the people that God would forgive even the worst sinner. Years later, an apostle of Christ and former Pharisee Paul argued that religious laws never had, never would, and never could save anyone from sin. That is the text we read in the beginning. Paul repeatedly said that the law was given to show us our need of a savior. who is superior to religion in every way possible. The law was given to us to inform us, to show us our need of a Savior who can heal us. The law can be compared with a thermometer. We use a thermometer to see our temperature when we are running a fever. The thermometer can only tell you that you are running 102 centigrade temperature, 102 degrees centigrade. But it has no capacity at all to cure you of the fever. We clung to the thermometer and did not bother about the treatment. That's the problem. Christ is superior to religion in any direction you look. Religion can be many good things, but it cannot be a substitute for Christ. In other faiths, it means you have to visit places of worship, pray to someone whom you don't know, go on pilgrimage, show kindness, give to the poor, feed the hungry, etc. A person can do all these things without experiencing any change in his life, any change within himself or herself. I live near a temple and I watch people pass by on the road outside. As they cross the temple, they would touch their forehead. And that is their way of paying obeisance to the deity inside whom they don't even know. They're in a hurry, they can't stop to enter the temple. So while passing on the road, they touch their forehead as if saluting the deity inside. And they feel, perhaps, that we don't know which God is inside. And if I'm passing outside, I must salute him because otherwise he may get angry. Here, their own ways is of prime importance, not that of the God whom they don't know. Because every time they need something, they come to the temple, they pray. And they make a promise that if I get this, then I will reply with this. In Christianity too, we think we have to attend religious services, show acts of kindness, avoid immorality, believe in God, have religious affiliation, get baptized, receive the communion, study the doctrine, read the scriptures, offer prayers, celebrate the religious events, give to the poor, sing in the choir, and get recognized as a godly person. We try to do all this. But is this enough? This is what religion wants you to do. But Christ is a person whom you must know and trust. Here comes the big difference. And I listed some 25 points, but I don't know whether I should go through that. Christ is someone who is very near. Christ is someone who has authority to help us. Christ is someone who can forgive us our sins. He is someone who can declare us righteous. He is someone who can set us apart for God. He is someone who can bring God to us, who can bring us to God, who can guide us, who can teach us, who can be our example, and he never leaves us alone. He is someone who can defend us, who is someone who can be trusted, and he is someone who can intercede for us. He is someone who can feel our pain. Praise God for that. Christ is someone who can give us joy, who can give us peace, who can give us hope, who can give us love. And he's someone who has proven his love for us and who has died for us and who has risen from the dead for us. This is where we stand. He's someone who can live his life through us. He's someone who can take us all the way home and who can assure us of heaven. It is a study in contrast, as you can find out, and it speaks to us today. I may be very active in church, in the prayer meetings, in the women's meetings, in the youth fellowship, in the choir, but being active is not going to please God unless your heart is right with Him. We can do all these things without being close to God. That is the big problem. When Jesus spoke against religious practices which did not change lives, he was ridiculed and he was targeted. He was attacked. Jesus knew the dangers of religion. He was hated by some of the most religious people in Israel. Baptism is one part of the Christian life. And we all agree that we have to get baptized. I have found many parents don't have the right idea about baptism. As secretary, many people come to me to discuss these things. And many come to me and say, you see, my son or my daughter has now completed college. He has found a job. Very soon he will be leaving the city. So why don't we get him baptized? He's already 22 years old. And I tell them, what have you been doing all these years? You could have got him or her baptized when he was 16 or 17 or 18. What stopped you? Nahi, hei to nahi, au kar daba. Why? Kaun kar debe? What you want to do? You must have the right idea what baptism is. Then you come and get baptized. They think it is a ritual their child should go through. It is mandatory. And otherwise, he cannot be a member of the church. And once he becomes a member of the church, then he will have the license to come and attend the general body meetings and make a big noise. That is also one part. A friend of mine, a very close friend of mine who studied with, he was my batchmate, once he came to me and said, virtually he ordered me, that I have managed to get a hotel booked for the for the dinner I'll be throwing for all my relatives and friends for my son's baptism. And it should be the first Sunday of next month because he will be leaving the city. And you have to get it done anyhow. I knew his son. He was part of the youth group. And he was part of the choir at that time, and I knew he was a believer. And I knew that he will get baptized on that day, there will be no problem. But I was very unhappy with my friend. I told him, who asked you to go and book the hotel? Did I tell you? Then he said, why you are asking me all these things? I have already done it and you don't know how much trouble I had to encounter. No hotels were available. I said, who told you that your son has qualified to get baptized? He has to pass through some rules. He has to pass through some scrutiny. Then he said, I didn't know all those things, but you have to get it done on that day. I said, I can't promise you. And he was very upset with me. I told him I could not help until I know whether his son has realized Christ's need for himself. How to make these people understand that unless someone realizes his or her utter helplessness, worthlessness, and need for Christ, till that time the question of baptism doesn't arise. It is when a person realizes his or her need for Christ, then comes the need for his seeking God's forgiveness and accept that Christ died for his or her sins, then only the question of baptism comes. Getting baptized is a commandment from Christ, and we have to obey. And baptism is a beautiful thing, a beautiful way of letting others know their need for Christ. The book of Isaiah, chapter 64, verse 6 says, "All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away." Think of Saul. Before his encounter with Christ, he thought his relationship with God was fine, rather great. In Acts 23, verse 6, he describes himself as a Pharisee and the son of a Pharisee. He thought his relationship with God was determined by his relationship to the law. That is where we fail. But after his transformation, he defined his standing with God in new terms. He now became more concerned about his faith in Christ rather than what the law says. Showing the love of Christ to others and reminding others that one day all of us will personally answer to Christ the Lord. A huge point that I have come to understand by the help of the Lord is this. Our understanding of our faith. We have many Christian families who are members of this church, who make no mistake of attending the worship every Sunday, rain or shine. I have seen them come to the church in blinding rain at the height of summer. They make it a point not to miss one opportunity to attend the worship. Every morning, they have worship at home. Every evening before they have their dinner, they have worship at home as well. The father is very committed. The father is particular that the children must attend Sunday school on Sunday. They must go to the Sunday school. They must worship. They must do whatever is needed to be done on a Sunday. But I always bothered why the boys and girls from such families who are to the outside such devout Christians, they go astray. Why? The son of Brother Paresh Das, he was the church secretary, everybody knows him. Why did he decide to marry an unbeliever? They come from good Christian families. I have seen many families where the parents are regular churchgoers. In spite of their involvement, they face big problems at home. Children, despite their exposure to the church atmosphere, to the church meetings, the church worships, long association with the Sunday school, and the children might be doing very well in the Sunday school exams. And I have very little interest in Sunday school exams. As secretary, I can tell you, That is a place where the children come to know who the Lord is, and they should know how to love Him. I don't mind if they score a 0 in the Sunday school exam. But if they score 100 out of 100 in every year's exam, and then finally take a decision that totally ruins their life, there is hardly any good in that. No one can be happy about it. So we stress where no stress is needed, and we totally ignore the areas where we must give utmost attention. I realized, the Lord told me, in fact, yesterday when I sat down with all these notes, the thought came to me, it's because the seed sown that never took roots and did not lead to their truly accepting Christ as their Lord and Savior. They make the suffering and death on the cross of Jesus redundant. But when the parents, they know the Lord, they not only practice the religion, they know the Lord, they love the Lord, they want their children to love the Lord also. In those families, such things hardly happen. If you can make a survey, you can find out. Unless the family is evangelical, the children will... Unless the family is evangelical, the children will not be evangelical. They will not know the Lord. They will not accept Christ as their Lord and Savior, and they will not allow Him to rule their lives, which is most important. That is where we fail. We may be doing very well in our religion, but God is not interested, I can tell you this morning. God wants to know how much you love Him, how much you want to follow Him, how much you want to trust Him for everything. And the day will come when, as a family, we can stand together, as a church, we can stand together, and we can say, Lord, we love you. We love you so much. May the Lord bless all of us.